crossing analyses of the IT industry and international relations. Welcome to the Tech Geopolitics Unveiled. I'm Rocky Urienkai. Today, we are going to discuss a country that is eagerly trying to catch up in the global semiconductor race, which is Singapore. Although small in size, only half of Hong Kong's, it is still ambitious with great achievements. Is it possible for it to become the world's seventh largest semiconductor power, to draw close to China at sixth? First of all, we need to know who are the top six players in the global semiconductor industry and the criteria to enter the ranking. Let's start with the promotion services before we officially enter today's program. The IT industry is changing rapidly. How can we grasp the most accurate and important information in the shortest time? DIGITIMES is the world's most professional Chinese language IT industry newspaper. DIGITIMES launches the mobile edition of DIGITIMES to help readers acquire first-hand industry information anytime and anywhere. Check out the description section below the video for more information about the mobile version of DIGITIMES. Many of you already know, since we talked about it in the last episode, that the top six superpowers or players in the global semiconductor industry are the US, Europe, and East Asia's Japan, Korea, Taiwan, and China. The judging point of this list is very simple. Production value each player contributes in the industry chain. Whoever contributes the most is the leader, and so on and so forth. Let's take a look at this chart, which is from the 2022 Factbook, published this year by the Semiconductor Industry Association, SIA, founded in 1977. In this chart from page 3, the six bars represent the top six superpowers in the semiconductor sector. Let's look at the leftmost side. The longest one is the US. Its share was 48%, an obvious number one. South Korea was in second place with 18%, while the shorter bars are Japan and Europe, each with 9%. Taiwan accounted for 8%. China on the far right only had 7%. Other countries' production values were all less than 1%, making them not eligible to enter the ranking. Then why did Singapore, which has more than 200 and almost 300 semiconductor firms today, only have a production value share of less than 1%? This is related to how the production values this ranking are calculated. As we explained in the last episode, it only calculates IDM and fabless, which are chips from vertical integrated manufacturers and chip designers. It does not count those from foundry service providers, such as the famous TSMC, as well as UMC Global Foundries, and even VIS and PSMC. The packaging and testing sectors also excluded, resulting in Taiwan and China both having such low shares. Of course, the upstream EDA IC designing tools and software, as well as chip manufacturing equipment and materials, are also out. So why are the rules set like that? Likely a habit of the industry. So we will not talk about it today. With the rules, it is rather simple for Singapore or any country or region to make it into this short ranking. That is to raise IDM and IC designs capacity, meaning that Singapore's chip production capacity in terms of global share will need to catch up with China, Taiwan, and even Japan and Europe to be able to make it into the list. And here's the key point. What is considered Singapore's chip capacity? It means that Singapore-based companies must be headquartered in Singapore. Well, that is the difficult part because Singapore doesn't have its own semiconductor manufacturing plant, neither IDM nor foundry, while chip designers with a sufficient business scale are also very limited there, although it doesn't have one now, it had one in the past. So up until this point, we can almost assert that with the rules, if Singapore wants to get into the ranking of the global semiconductor superpowers in the foreseeable future, I emphasize again that according to the rules set by this ranking, that is ranked by contribution, the chance for Singapore to get in is slim. So is the EDB of the Singaporean government trying to change this situation? Let's explain why Singapore has had chip capacity in the past, but now it doesn't have any local semiconductor maker, as it will help in answering the question. 36 years ago in 1987, in 2000, the Singaporean government's sovereign fund, the well-known Temasek Holdings, purchased Chartered, making the company not only a domestic enterprise, but also a state-owned one, and its operation was excellent, with the firm listed on both the Singapore Exchange and NASDAQ, and at one time was the third largest foundry in the world, behind only TSMC and UMC. However, in the second half of 2009, the Singaporean government efficiently sold Chartered in a couple of months, from announcing the plan to finishing it. To whom did it sell? Global Foundries, which was spun off from AMD. Since then, Singapore has not had any large local semiconductor manufacturers. 2 years later, in 2011, The government also sold its largest chip design company, Avago Technologies, and a packaging and testing company, Stats ChipPack. The latter was sold to China-based JSET. Here you will definitely want to ask, what was the reason behind this series of operations? Was the Singapore government giving up on the semiconductor industry? Yeah, that's the reason. Some Taiwanese media called this decision the decision by the Singaporean government, Singapore's semiconductor major strategic retreat. And the reason Singapore did it was because the government saw handsets drive up the business opportunity of mobile network while revenues from the semiconductor industry were weakening at the time and was therefore decided to pull away from these capital-intensive and labor-intensive industries to develop emerging industries such as financial. Singapore's IT manufacturing industries were very prosperous before, but it has been virtually stagnant since then, with the manufacturing industry's share in Singapore's GDP declining from 25% for a long time to roughly 20%. Then there is certainly a topic worth discussing here. That is, should the government be applauded for its courage in proposing an industrial policy to adjust the industrial structure? Perhaps it is a matter of opinion. Those who are inclined to liberalism will surely say that the government only needs to create a good business environment. Don't make a decision for the industries, since civil servants don't know more about the industries than entrepreneurs do. But we have seen that the Singaporean government has chosen transportation, shipbuilding, ship repair, petrochemicals, trading, banking, and other industries for development and was successful. In the 90s, when the government trying to assist the semiconductor industry by setting up SGD 2 billion worth of venture capital fund and cluster development fund to facilitate the formation of industry clusters and strengthen the structure of the industry, which were obviously the policies of the Singaporean government at that time, to actively intervene and provide guidance and the key to the success of Singapore's semiconductor industry at that time. Therefore, if someone now wants to criticize the Singaporean government's decision for a strategic retreat, it is just hindsight. Neither is it fair. The point is that the plan cannot catch up with the change. And when the change occurs again, has the Singaporean government made any new plan to catch up with the change? Yes. With the US-China tech war starting in 2018 and a global chip shortage breaking out in 2020, the Singapore government is seeing all of it happen. So in December 2020, at the end of 2020 actually, the Singapore government announced the Research, Innovation and Enterprise 2025 Plan and Fund for the National Research Foundation. The plan is for the government to provide funding equivalent to 1% of GDP over a five-year period from 2021 to 2025. As an investment to sustain research, innovation, and enterprise, approximately US$25 billion is available to support the IT semiconductor industry so it can grasp the new growth opportunities. In other words, Singapore retreated from the semiconductor industry and is now having a great comeback. Its goal for the manufacturing industry is by 2030, the entire industry will pick up 50%, with the semiconductor sector being the most important. Doesn't it sound a lot like China's Made in China 2025, where everyone has a national team? Okay, back to our question for today's episode. So, is it possible for Singapore to become the seventh largest semiconductor superpower in the world? It is still rather slim. Why? Note that I'm not saying that there will be fewer semiconductor firms in Singapore, but that there will be more of them with bigger scale, while their capacity will also be increased. From SSIA's website, I have found information about its members, and I have counted them one by one to know that the total number of members is 234. Of course, there may still be a few that have not joined SSIA, but the number is a little less than the peak of about 300 in around 2010. So what's the key point? Most of these companies are international firms from various countries, and to Singapore they are foreign-invested, multinational companies set up in Singapore, including Taiwan's TSMC, UMC and VIS, Europe's Infineon and ST Microelectronics, and US HP, Supermicro and Global Foundries, all are foreign companies. In March this year I had visited Singapore and met with their officials and SSIA, and they emphasized that although Singapore is a small country, Malaysia, which has a strong development in the packaging field, is its neighbor. And the entire ASEAN countries are all its hinterland for semiconductor development. So it doesn't matter if it is small, the big hinterland is the key. This makes it a really ambitious player. To be fair, it is only Singapore taking a different approach to semiconductor development. And the fact that it does not enter the ranking does not mean that there is no way for it to develop the semiconductor industry. Furthermore, although it does not have its own domestic manufacturers and can only provide a good business environment for semiconductor companies from other countries, it's also possible to create jobs and GDP. So there's nothing wrong with that, is there? Of course, the prerequisite for adopting this kind of business strategy is what Lee Kuan Yew, who founded Singapore, and Lee Hsien Loong, who is about to retire, have been emphasizing that Singapore does not choose sides. It's about maintaining equidistant diplomacy among the world's powers. And that's obviously something that Singapore has done very well so far. So can other countries learn from it? That's all for this episode. This program is broadcast on Tuesday every 2 weeks. Please subscribe to us. Give us a like, share and forward this video. And also leave your comments to let us know your thoughts.